And the first speaker is another great colleague of mine, Pete West Oram. He's a member of the ethics team here at Brighton and Sussex Medical School, a political philosopher by training, but now a very experienced bioethicist. And Pete's work is very much focused on the sort of reciprocal obligations that we have to one another in society and the ways that those play out, particularly in relation to health. And as his talk will demonstrate, one of the areas that he's really shone a light on is the conceptual idea of solidarity and how that does, or sometimes sadly does not, play out in modern society. So here's Pete.
Thanks, Bobby. I'll just share the screen. So, brilliant. Thanks very much indeed. Cheers, Bobby. Cheers, Matt. Thanks for the introduction. It's wonderful to be with everyone today. It's been a really fun couple of days hearing all the different perspectives. As Bobby said, I'm a political philosopher and bioethicist here at Brighton Sussex Medical School. And the talk that I'm going to be giving is sort of a talk based on two papers of mine that have come out over the last couple of years, looking at the role of solidarity in various different responses to certain kinds of threats. So I'm going to be talking about antimicrobial resistance, but it's going to be kind of his antimicrobial resistance as a type or a token of a type of problem that we look at in global health generally in terms of global health justice. So it's antimicrobial resistance with lots more solidarity than antimicrobial resistance. So I kind of thought that there's lots of people who do this kind of stuff in a lot more detail and a lot more specificity, and it would be more useful if I lent more onto what I do and how it relates to antimicrobial resistance than repeat what other people have said. So this is from the O'Neill report, which was mentioned yesterday by a couple of people, looking at antimicrobial resistance worldwide, which came out in 2014. And as we can see, that it recognises that the problem of AMR is global in scale. And while it's just something that is affecting everyone, as we've heard particularly this morning as well in the UK, it is a global problem that is disproportionately going to affect, or is already disproportionately affect, people in poorer and countries with less well-developed or less resilient healthcare systems. So while we're looking at 10 or predicted 10 million deaths related to or from antimicrobial resistance by 2050, the vast majority of those are anticipated to come in Asia and Africa, largely as a result of lack of resources to respond to antimicrobial resistant infections. So while in some discourse surrounding it, the language is often phrased in terms of we're all in the same boat, it isn't really the case. It's much more a case of we're in the same ocean, but some of us have got much nicer boats than others. But regardless, the waves are picking up, or have been picking up for a long time, and the clouds are starting to look a lot more unpleasant than they were, well, not even recently. So that's sort of the extent of the detail of antimicrobial resistance for today. I hope you'll forgive me if I talk in more general terms for the rest of the session. But as I say, I'll be talking mostly about solidarity and its relationship to responses to COVID, antimicrobial resistance and a couple of other different super wicked problems in global health. And the timing is kind of nice because with relating to questions of solidarity, so many of us will be on strike for the rest of this week or other industries as well. So for those of you unfamiliar with Jorts the cat, a viral thing on Twitter, who has become sort of a quasi-comedic solidarity representative of worker solidarity worldwide. And they framed it quite nicely. Solidarity is sticking together, even though our needs aren't all the same. Solidarity is fighting until everyone has what they need, which is kind of a nice way of thinking about it. And there are, of course, a lot of different definitions of solidarity. It is a concept with a very lengthy history, obviously. The one I tend to like, or tend to work with the most, is that provided by Barbara Prainsack and Elena Books. Not just because I used to work with Elena, but it does happen to cover an awful lot of the terrain that I think is useful in most different definitions of solidarity. So an enacted commitment to carry costs, financial, social, emotional, or otherwise, to assist others with whom a person or persons recognize similarity in a relevant respect. And the key point here is that it is not just an emotional connection. It is not just feeling sorry for people. It is active. It is not just, oh, yes, that's terrible. Isn't it a shame? It has to be an actual engagement with another person or group of persons. The other key point in this definition is that it's identification with or recognition of similarity with other persons. Another definition I really like is provided by Angus Dawson and Bruce Jennings, that standing up with, standing up for, and standing up as another person. So it's the key element here is that it's based on a recognition of similarity, so it's and it's active. And this is important because it distinguishes it in a meaningful way from charitable action. It is not something that is kind of, oh, you poor thing, I'll help you because I'm powerful if you're not. It is, this is a person like me in some way, and that can come in a number of different aspects. Historically, it's been seen as something that's quite a thick concept, so we connect most closely with solidarity with shared religion, shared language, shared nationality, but it can come in lots of different ways that are more transient or more passing. So it might be giving up one seat on a bus is the example of Barbara and Eleni use to someone because you recognize they're more in need of the seat, but you are a person like them or based on shared experience. The other important thing is that it's egalitarian, not hierarchical, which is something that charitable responses can often fall into, a kind of hierarchy of power discrepancy. So there are some important things that happen within solidarity. Equally, and this is going to come in later, there tends to be an assumption that solidarity is always positive or is generally pro-social. It is a good thing to do. It is something we should do or something we should aim towards, which in many ways is true, but in other ways is less true. And that's the second part of the paper, as it were. The challenge with how we think about solidarity, particularly for things like antimicrobial resistance, like pandemic disease and like climate change, is that historically it tends to be easier with people who are closer to us psychologically or geographically. And this isn't a normative claim. This isn't something, this is a good thing to do, but it just as a psychological contingency, it tends to be simpler for people or easier when we are proximate to one another in some way, which can create challenges when the problems that we're dealing with are global or when they are found or that might affect people differently. So what we have with the problem identified with royalty is that if we think of the blue ovoid as the people to whom solidarity or moral concern is owed, often, and this is obviously not geographical or anything like this, there tend to be groups that are seen as beyond the range of moral concern or beyond the range of particular moral concern. We can have particular groups that are more or less close to people who we view as a psychological habit, in a sense, as being more or less close to that group or outside of it, either because of geographical or psychological distance and perceptions of difference. The challenge, therefore, is expanding that blue ovoid to all moving people psychologically from outside of the group internally. So that we want to move from this situation of there's our group, whoever that may be, and there's some other groups who, yes, we think they're fine, but they've got their own problems and they can deal with those kinds of things. And this is a problem in global justice generally, and particularly with these global problems. So, as I said, it's a talk in two papers, and the first of which was published a few years ago, and Elena and I wrote this paper looking at three core case studies on antimicrobial resistance, climate change, and pandemic disease. And in it, we argued that these kinds of problems are so challenging, so dangerous, so threatening, that they should serve as a kind of motivation to engage in collaboration globally. And there's a couple of different shoulds. The first is a normative or moral should. This is something that should serve as a moral set of reasons to engage in collaboration for relevant actors to engage in solidaristic cooperation worldwide. The second is predictive, that if this is so bad, or if this is as bad as it seems to be the case, people are likely to engage in solidarity more actively or be more likely to engage in solidarity more actively. We'll see how accurate or how correct we were in that in a moment. So the goal really is to try and overcome this challenge of perceptions of distance and difference. And this is an illustration from Andre Carrillo about the Ebola crisis in 2014. And what happened there is there was, as we may remember, there was a massive overemphasis on what was happening to wealthy white people in wealthy countries, and a massive and largely kind of ignoring what's happening to poorer people who were largely living in, well, not even in sub-Saharan Africa. So the illustration, for if it's not coming through too clearly on the screen, two white journalists looking or focusing exclusively on the one white patient in a room full of black patients. So there's a massive panic on, oh, there's a massive threat of Ebola, we need to close the borders, we've got to stop people coming from Africa, ignoring the fact that this was regional, this was localized, and actually much more impactful in those regions. And there are lots of people who are now further away from those regions in Africa than people who were in Europe, who were panicking about their own risk. So the goal of this paper is trying to overcome these psychological or nationalist statist assumptions to try and respond effectively, or a framework for responding effectively or thinking effectively about these kinds of problems. So in a sense, it's a kind of a brute force kind of argument. There's self-interest that comes up because of these fears. This is something that is kind of sensible to be worried about. This is something that hopefully will motivate cooperation in response to these kinds of problems, where cooperation may not be initially a priority, or maybe a concern, because of, well, we want to do this and that's not in our interest to help people living in other countries, or however we might frame these things. That cooperation is hopefully grounds for a recognition of similarity in terms of vulnerability, because as I mentioned earlier, the victims of antimicrobial resistance are, while this is going to affect people in wealthier countries as well, primarily this is going to, the outcomes are going to be worse for people living in poorer countries and poorer people living in these countries. And then hopefully through that awareness of similarity in terms of vulnerability to infection, and particularly with something like climate change, this is something that will hopefully encourage a recognition of similarity and serve as a catalyst towards solidarity for global health more generally. So in a sense, it's kind of a Hobbesian kind of argument. We all are vulnerable. Some of us are more vulnerable than others, but we are all relevantly vulnerable in the same way. So we engage in cooperation to escape from the state to the figurative epidemiological climate-based state of nature. So we have a sovereign of some kind, whatever that may be, and cooperate so that we can engage effectively for everyone's welfare. And this is obviously the illustration of the sovereign from cover of Hobbes' Leviathan, and it's also my favourite slide that I've ever made in my career. For those of you unfamiliar with the work of Bill Watson, this is the Tiger Hobbes from the Garden of Hobbes cartoon. So we have this strategy, which hopefully we have fear, we can recognise that we're all similarly vulnerable, or relevantly similarly vulnerable, even though there's massive discrepancies. That helps us to recognise that we're similar, that helps us to catalyse moving to a solidaristic response to this challenge. The second paper. Obviously COVID-19 is a very different kind of scenario to antimicrobial resistance. And in this paper, what I was looking at was how various different nations have responded to the COVID pandemic, particularly the United States and the UK. And in some ways, we have seen a massive response in solidarity in response to the pandemic, which I'll talk about in a moment. But unfortunately, in many ways, we haven't seen it from some of the people who we most need it from. So the title, Solidarity is for Other People, is partly a recognition of what it is that we do solidarity for. We engage in solidarity in response to the needs of other people so that we can help other people. We engage in solidarity to help others. Unfortunately, the response by certain governments and certain agents is the other meaning of this, that, well, solidarity is something that other people can do. It's not my concern, it's something I'm gonna look out for myself, and you can do what you want, but I don't really care because I've got mine. And unfortunately, some of the people engaging in that second meaning were in government in the UK at the time. So we see things like the garden parties in the UK, we see various different approaches of lockdown rules. We have various different people. I should have given a content warning for these people. I do apologise. I say that somewhat facetiously, but I do actually mean that, because every time I use this slide, it makes me furious. We have Rishi Sunak promoting the eat out to help out, which we now know, as and loads of people predicted, massively drove COVID infections, made people vulnerable, because we needed to protect the restaurant sector, which, okay, there's a need to do that, but there's also recognition that this directly led to massive excess morbidity and mortality. And Dominic Cummings, who broke lockdown to drive to Durham to test his vision at Barnard Castle for some reason and potentially expose lots of other people to infection. And then we have like two of the worst people in the world, Donald Trump and Boris Johnson, who through their policies, through the statements that they made, through their behaviour, actively undermined responses to COVID-19. So the actions here are solidaristic in a sense, but with a very narrow range. And then we have Lawrence Fox, the world's most boring contrarian, who actively seem to be opposing any kind of solidaristic response to COVID-19, seemingly hoping for a kind of Jordan Peterson type career of being a public contrarian. This is at the time when you weren't allowed to do any of these things, and he was bragging about how it is, you know, we don't need to do this, how dare you tell me that I need to do this, it's somebody else's problem. So almost verbatim saying this is something for somebody else to worry about, not my problem, Jack. So we have these examples where, on the one hand, that paper one, look, this is something terrifying, this should encourage people to cooperate, this is a moral reason, this is predictive, and hopefully this will happen. And then you have these people who are doing exactly the opposite of what we predicted. As I say, however, I do think that it is right that these kinds of things should serve as moral reasons. And in some ways, we did have a lot of action to engage in solidarity. So unfortunately, as I say, this is not the absence of solidarity, unfortunately. In some ways, that would almost be better. What we have from these examples is a solidarity of a much narrower type, of a much less pro-social type, which is, I'm going to look after my particular interests, and we can look at how funding for various different responses to COVID-19 was distributed by the British government over the last few years, and who has benefited from that, and who should have benefited from that. It is a type of solidarity which is much narrower. It is a type of solidarity which is actively exclusionary, and it is a type of solidarity which is actively harmful to lots of other people. So what's happened is the reverse of what we want to do on that initial slide, which is take people who should be engaged in that community of solidarity and move them out or to the periphery because of narrower interests of people with a lot of power. And we also see this as well with much less impactful kinds of ways on a much smaller scale. So we have this situation where it's kind of an example, A, of how that initial paper was slightly more optimistic than it perhaps should have been, though I think it, in many ways it does function well, but also of the wider range and the greater complexity of the concept of solidarity, because while there is literature on ways in which solidarity can be harmful, it's a bit narrow, it's not quite as detailed, and there isn't quite as much of an exploration of how that functions. However, to avoid ending on a pessimistic note, we have seen in response to COVID-19 that lots and lots and lots of people did engage in very costly behaviour. They were willing to carry costs for other people with whom they recognise similarity. We did see people wearing masks all the time. We did see people or helping their neighbours. We did see responses in terms of a general willingness, at least initially, to engage in solidaristic behaviour, which was costly for people, to avoid seeing family members, to minimise their contact with other people, to wear masks, to social distance. And equally, we saw this response from the World Health Organization focusing on the importance of global solidarity, and obviously an organization grounded in this idea anyway, but the emphasis on the use of the concept as being something that we should all be engaging in to talk about the clinical trials for COVID-19 treatment. So while on the one hand there is the failures of solidarity and the narrowing of solidarity in by some very powerful agents who we have good reason to wish they had acted otherwise, other agents did actually engage in solidarity, at least while this was encouraged. And we can see things how I was on the first flight I took since 2019. I was sitting at the front of the plane with a mask on, where flights still had to have masks on, and the flight attendants were saying, I can't wait till we don't have to wear masks anymore. And I was like, I've literally just been giving a talk about this. I've got my laptop. I can show you the slides. And I think that comes from a general environmental narrative of, oh, we're done now. And I think that is this is all fine. And I think the challenge is making sure that narrative is, that we pursue a much better narrative of this is something that is ongoing, and the same with antimicrobial resistance. How long have we got?
Not long.
Okay, I'm nearly done. Sorry, I've got a clock there, but I wasn't looking at it carefully enough at the start. So again, we have, without being too negative, we do have these responses which are solidaristic, which do engage in this willingness to carry costs, but we have to acknowledge that there are also these narrower solidaristic responses which are harmful and are actively opposed to a more general solidarity. And if we don't, we're in trouble. I'll leave it there, but if I mentioned the idea of super-witted problems earlier, but if I have another slide, but I'm happy to take on questions there. So, and I'll stop.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Luke.